tonight. Here's the goal. We have 2 weeks together, this week and next week, and I want to talk a little bit about the Bible, which is a great topic for church. Particularly, I want to look at one aspect, which is I want to talk about your time in the Word. I want to talk actually about time with the Lord, devotions, quiet time, communion with God, whatever you want to call it. I don't really care the label too much. But I want to try to share what God's been doing in my life, I think, over the last year or so. And trying to lay down maybe a new vision for what my time in the Word is supposed to look like. And so what I want to do tonight is three things, and then we'll follow up on this next week. But tonight, I simply want to reestablish the fact that it is a necessity to feed your soul on the Word of God, that we don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I just want to spend some time doing that. But then I want to give a warning on the other side of that, that there is a way to read the Bible that kills, not feeds your soul. Okay, it's entirely possible to do this thing completely wrong. And then third, I want to lay a vision for something different. What would it look like to have a very simple but profound approach to Bible reading and quiet time that might transform the way we think about that? And then next week, we're going to get uber practical. And we're just going to try to, in some nuts and bolts, flesh out what it looks like to feed or nourish our souls in the Word of God. And so tonight, I'm trying to lay a foundation and cast a little vision that next week we'll fill some of the holes in from. All right? So that's the goal. What time do we end this, Pat? I want to make sure I don't go over.
20 till we're done.
Okay, got it. Done. All right. So if you have a Bible, I want you to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4. That's where we're going to start out. It can be a little taxing for me in the ministry. I turned 30 years old just after I started the Ministry of Salt Company, and I noticed come the beginning of this summer that I was starting to have a little bit of that 30-year-old flab, you know, getting soft around the midsection, right? You know that feeling where you, like, press on your stomach and it feels kind of like a Tempur-Pedic mattress pad? Your hand kind of sinks in a little bit? I was having a little bit of that. So I started asking around at Cornerstone Church, where's a good place to work out? And so I got advice from the teaching pastor, Jeff Dodge, who will actually be doing the Thrive Marriage Conference for you guys in just a couple weeks. Jeff, if you don't know Jeff is very fit. He has some of the best-looking triceps I've ever seen on a human being. And he's old, too. Like, probably, I mean, close to as old as Pat. So very old, very old. The type of elderly that you don't expect to have triceps like that, right? And so I asked Jeff, I'm like, Jeff, where do you work out? He works at a place called Surefire in Ames. So I decided, okay, this summer, Jeff, I'm going to work out with you at Surefire. Which someone asked me what it was like working out with Jeff. Two thoughts come to mind. Number one, extremely humbling to see a man who should be using a walker doing like 75 push-ups, just, and I'm over here dying, and he's just killing this workout, laughing and joking with me. Isn't this great, Mark? Ha, ha, ha. No, it feels like death, Jeff. Be quiet. I'm trying to get through this. And it's at 6 in the morning, which is a terrible time to do anything other than read the Bible and have coffee. That's the only thing you should do at that time in the morning. I'm there killing myself with Jeff Dodge working out. It's like taking your money, handing it to someone, and then having them taser you, you know? Going to bed that night thinking, how could I hurt everywhere? How can my face? I remember having facial muscles that I think I strained. And I'm like, was I just gritting my teeth out? Then you wake up the next morning, hand him more money, and have him tase you again. That was what that exercise program was like. And yet I did it because I knew if I wanted to be healthy, I had to pay the price, right? We all know that, right? No pain, no gain. It takes sacrifice. It takes hard work to get that level of tricep definition. Effort will be required. So 1 Timothy 4, verses 6 through 10, but I want to just point us particularly to verse 7 and 8, because Paul picks up on that athletic training metaphor, and he says this, don't have anything to do with irreverent and silly myths, rather train yourself for godliness. That call, athletic work, training, hard work will be necessary if you're going to be godly. No one ever accidentally falls into godliness. Like you're just walking along like, oh my goodness, I became holy. That does not happen at all. Rather, you will have to train yourself, for the training of the body, verse 8, has a limited benefit. It's not no benefit, okay? You don't have to give up your gym membership. It's just simply limited benefit. But godliness is beneficial in every way, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. So training is required if we are to aspire to a life of godliness, a life that looks like loving God and loving other people. And then in particular, I want you to see this. In 1 Timothy, Paul is concerned with false teachers who are invading the church. So he began 1 Timothy 4, if you look at the beginning of the chapter, confronting this false teaching, which is wrapped up in abandoning things that God created as good, rejecting marriage, rejecting certain types of foods. This type of false teaching is actually characterized by a rigorous form of discipline and self-denial, right? So right on the heels of that, I think Paul's afraid that in our lives, as well as in Timothy's life, since we see legalistic forms of self-discipline, which we need to reject, we might just reject the whole idea of self-discipline and hard work altogether. So rather, and we just pendulum swing and say, anybody who wants to work hard and train themselves to be godly, that person's just a legalist, right? But it's not legalistic to call for hard work and training in godliness. There's certain things that Paul then uses to distinguish what he's calling us to from what the false teachers would. And one of them is, if you look at verse 6 here, he says, Timothy, if you point these things out to the brothers, you're going to be a good servant of Christ Jesus, constantly nourished by the words of the faith and the good teaching that you have followed. But have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. So you see the contrast Paul gives there? He says, Timothy, these false teachers are passing off man-made doctrines, silliness. But you, in contrast to that, need to devote yourself to nourishing your soul on truth, on God's word. So one of the hallmarks of a Christ-centered approach to spiritual growth and spiritual discipline is that the content matter of that nourishing of the soul is words of the faith and the good teaching that you've followed. I think this is really, really key. It's one of the most explicit times in the New Testament where we're told that the scriptures are absolutely essential for spiritual health and vitality. To nourish your soul on truth will take giving yourself to knowing the Word of God, right? So I'm just setting that up to say, we need to understand that we don't live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. God's word is essential if we are to nourish and grow and feed our souls. But, now, I don't think, by the way, that this text in 1 Timothy 4 is a call, for instance, to daily devotions explicitly. I don't think we have a call in the Bible explicitly to daily devotions. The only reason for that is because very few people at the time of the writing of this epistle from Paul to Timothy would have had access personally to a copy of the scriptures, right? The scriptures were exceedingly rare for individuals to possess in the time of the first century. So there's nowhere where you're going to read where he's going to say to every person hearing my words, you need to have daily time in the word, simply because that would have been functionally impossible for a large number of people. But I want to make this point. While the scriptures aren't going to explicitly tell you that, I think they're implying that. In this, the statement, you must nourish your soul on truth. Here's what I mean. No one has to tell me, hey, Mark, you need to feed your body daily, right? Or you'll die. You felt like if I use the analogy of physical food, it's obvious I'm not missing a lot of meals and aims, okay? It's not like, oh man, I just went for days and I had no sense that I need anything to eat. That would be really messed up. You would say, actually, to a person who has no sensation of hunger, there's something really wrong with you physically, right? Take that on the spiritual level. While I can't give you an explicit call in the scripture to say daily you need to feed your soul with the word of God in a quiet time or something like that, what I can tell you is this. If you have no sensation of spiritual hunger and you go days without the word of God, there's something spiritually sick with you. There's something actually really wrong with your soul. So while our problem, therefore, is not the problem of the first century church of limited access to the Bible, right? How many of you guys, for instance, like right now, you have a smartphone with you and you are reading the Bible on that smartphone or tablet device? I did this test at Cornerstone recently. Yeah, a ton of them, right? I see like the glowing screen on me. How many of you are checking ESPN.com while you're doing that? Heath? I know you will, okay? I do it too, okay? I'm not condoning that. I'm just saying lots of us wonder what the scores are to the games when we get here at 6:30. So if you have a smartphone with you, you have instant access to the scripture. Go download the YouVersion app, right? And you can get access to almost all of the major versions of the Bible, translations of the Bible that have been done in English, like that, instantly. Our problem is not the same problem the first century church had, in other words. Our problem is the opposite, right? We have almost unlimited access to the scriptures. I counted in my office today, I have 36 copies of the Bible in English. I have 34 now, because I told people today at Cornerstone, if they came up to me, I would give them one of those, so I gave away two of them. So I have 34 now. 34 copies of the Bible. People in the history of the church would have died for that privilege. So our problem is not that we don't have the Bible, but that somehow in the midst of the abundance of what access that we have, we're like taking that for granted maybe. I don't know whether it's due to laziness or an over-busyness of life or the fact that there's just something really, really spiritually sick in us that we don't sense the need for the scriptures. We don't hunger and thirst for them. Very simple statement that I'm trying to make at the outset is this. No one will grow into godliness who doesn't give themselves to knowing God through his word. It's an impossibility. Any more than someone would grow physically without nourishing themselves with food. The scripture is critical to stir your heart to know God, to love others, to live a life that's worthy of the gospel. But, okay, so that's, I'm just setting us up to say, this is critical. Now here's the warning. Here's the warning coming. Note carefully, though, godliness is not a guaranteed result of excellent Bible reading. Because the people we see in the New Testament who are perhaps the most fervently devoted to a planned reading and study of the scriptures are the Pharisees, the very people who opposed and murdered Jesus. That should be a little bit scary because that means you can be the Bible quiz champion of the universe and murder the Son of God. So we need to figure out what sets apart a healthy perspective of reading and nourishing our souls from the Word of God from a Pharisaical approach to reading the Word. So to get there, let's go to John 5 real quick, okay? John chapter 5. Jesus has just done a miracle in John 5 where he has healed a lame man by telling him to pick up his mat and walk, right? Pick up your mat, walk. A man who was lame for 38 years picks up his bed mat and begins walking. And the Pharisees are on the scene. These Jewish religious leaders are on the scene watching this occur, and they see a dude who hasn't walked in 38 years walking, and what's their first response? Not, holy cow, you're walking. But what are you doing carrying your bed mat on the Sabbath? Who in the world would tell a lame person to carry their bed mat on the Sabbath? We need to explain this just briefly. The Pharisees are a strict Jewish sect. They knew and had a passion for knowing the Old Testament. From the writings that we have, a number of the Pharisees in their studies by the age of 12 would have memorized the Torah. In completion, that's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. By age 12. Do you know any 12-year-olds? How in the world? I'm just shocked by that. I've met some 12-year-olds. It looks like our brains are getting dumber. From there, they would have continued on, many of them, to memorize by age 18 the rest of the Old Testament. Okay, so just... this is what I did when I'm thumbing back. That is, in the copy of the Bible I have here, 881 pages. Memorized. So these people know the Bible, okay? They're obsessive about it. To the point where they're obsessive about the laws and the commands they studied. They had cataloged all the rules in the Old Testament, right? But here's the difficulty. If you have a rule like this one, say, don't do any work on the Sabbath, you have to understand what that rule means. What actually is work, for instance, right? So let's say plowing the field. Would you say, so let's just take a poll. Is plowing the field, is that work? Yes. Okay, they would have agreed to that. Yes, plowing the field is work. What about preparing a meal? Is preparing a meal work? Yes, actually, they would have said that. Yes, they would have said, so you would have had to prepare all the meals the day before and had them all set out. How about this one? Is dressing yourself work? Yes, if it's skinny jeans. I made that up. That's not in any... I thought that was a good joke, though. So you only wear sweatpants on the Sabbath because those aren't hard to pull on, right? No, that's not true. That's not true. I made that up. But the Pharisees literally developed a document called the Mishnah where that's what they did. They said, what is work? And they went through and meticulously went through all of life and said, this is work, this isn't, this is work, this isn't. They're explaining the law. And in the Mishnah, there is a line that specifies that carrying an object, and literally the illustration in the Mishnah is such as a bedroll on the Sabbath from one area to another constitutes work. Now, is the Mishnah the Bible? No. It's a list of man-made rules that try to explain how to live according to the Bible, right? So the Pharisees are on the scene, and they see a guy carrying his bedroll, and their first question is not, how did you get healed, but who told you to carry that bed mat? How dare you break the Sabbath? Now, if you are that guy, all I can imagine is you are incredibly confused, right? Literally, a person says, stand up and walk. You've not walked in 38 years, and you stand up and walk. And you're carrying your bedroll around. I imagine you're twirling that bad boy around your head, you know? And the Pharisees spot you say, who told you to walk? And I'm thinking, I'm walking, man. He did. Isn't it incredible, right? I can even twirl this bedroll. And they are reaming him out. So then we get to John 5, 31, and the Pharisees go to Jesus and say, what right do you have to do that? And Jesus says, well, there's four witnesses that testify me. There's four witnesses that tell you that it's valid for me to act in this way. So watch the four. Verse 31, start out, Jesus says, if I testify about myself, my testimony is not valid. There is another who testifies about me. This is testimony number one, testimony of God himself. And I know that the testimony he gives about me is valid. You have sent messengers to John. Here's testimony number two, witness two of Christ's authority. And he's testified to the truth. I don't receive man's testimony, but I say these things so that you may be saved. John was a burning and a shining lamp, and for a time you were willing to enjoy his life. But I have a greater testimony than John's because of the works that the Father has given me to accomplish. These very works, like healing a guy who hasn't walked in 38 years, these testify about me. That's the third testimony, right? That the Father has sent me. The Father who sent me has himself testified about me. You have not heard his voice at any time, and you haven't seen his form. You don't have his word living in you. Imagine saying that to a group of people who memorized the Old Testament. You don't have his word living in you because you don't believe the one he sent. You pore over the scriptures because you think you have eternal life in them, yet they testify about me. That's the fourth testimony. The scriptures themselves that you have memorized 881 pages of testify about me, and you are not willing to come to me so that you may have life. Pharisees, I've got the right to do what I do because it's witnessed by God himself, by John, by the miracles, and by the very scriptures you've given your lives to know. You see what he's claiming there? If anyone in the Bible would have said, we nourish our souls daily on the word of God, it would have been the Pharisees. And he's saying to these people, you don't know the Bible because you're missing me. You don't know the Bible. That's like saying to Pastor Pat, you don't know the Colts. Right? He's obsessed about the Colts. Like saying to Heath, you don't know what's going on in the world of football. He's reading ESPN.com right now. How can it be possible to have the whole Old Testament memorized and not know the Bible? How's that possible? It's possible because you can miss the forest from the trees. You can miss the point of the story because at its core, while the Bible contains rules, the Bible isn't a rule book. At a more foundational level, the Bible is a drama. It's the story of God. And the hero of that story is, what's his name, class? Jesus. So that if you miss him, you miss the point. The same error of the Pharisees is absolutely an error that we can fall into today. Right? That's the warning I want to give us here. I want to ask you, what's the main reason you should read the Bible every morning? Really? Why? What's the reason you read the Scriptures? I think a lot of Christians would answer something like this. Because the Bible's full of truth. And in a world gone wrong, the one thing you can count on is the truth of the Scripture. Now, is that true? Yes. Amen. Many would say the Bible is full of wisdom. To navigate the tricky path of the life of a college student, you need wisdom, right? So go to the Scriptures for it. Is that true? Yes. Yes. Or maybe some would say, you'd say, the reason we should get into the Bible is because it's full of instruction. It tells us what we should do and how we should live a life that pleases God. Is that true? Yes. Yes. Some would simply say the Bible is a fascinating work of literature. It's incredibly valuable. That's also true. But what I'm saying is, the Pharisees would have said true to all those statements too. They would have said it contains truth and wisdom and instruction and it's fascinating, and they missed the point. Because what's the more basic reason we should read the Bible? I think at the core it's just simply this, to know God through Jesus Christ. This was a book about Jesus. It's not just full of principles for how you should live tomorrow. It's a story of a person who you should worship tomorrow. So we don't just read the Bible for wisdom, for life, or rules to follow. We read the Bible to know Jesus. And that's my warning. It's entirely possible to do your devos wrong. So here's the last thing, and it's simple and it's short. I just want to cast a vision for you tonight. A vision for reading the Scripture, not simply to know rules, not simply to know what to do, but to commune with God personally through Jesus, because this book is all about him. We'll talk more about how we see this in the Scripture next week, but this book, from cover to cover, is a story that points us to Jesus, both in the macro, the overarching story of Scripture, where you have a God who creates the world, right, and man who falls in sin and rebels against God, and who's separated from God by his sin. And then what do we have? What can possibly make a way? The Old Testament is setting us up, right? It's not going to be our good deeds. It's not going to be our keeping of the law. It's going to be a sacrifice. It's going to be blood that covers and atones for sin. And then we get to the New Testament and look for a lamb, and what do we find? The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, Jesus. The perfect Lamb of God, the one who can set right all the wrongs in the world, who can forgive my sins, and who can take all the effect of the sinful curse in the world, and who can roll that back. That's the macro. The big storyline of the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, it's a story of God's redeeming work through Jesus. It's him setting right what sin has gotten wrong. But even in the micro, in the small stories, in the paragraph that you're going to read tomorrow in your time in the Word, in the story you're going to read in the Old Testament, all of even those micro stories find their place within the broader drama of redemption and lead us and point us to Jesus. I'm going to do this in a minute with one that you know really, really well. Only a boy named David, right? You know the rest of it. You could only a little sling. Only a boy named David, but he could pray and sing. Only a boy named David. Only a rippling brook. Only a boy named David. And the five little stones he took. Then one little stone went into the sling, and the sling went round and round. And here's where it gets lyrically creative. And round 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 and round. And one little stone went up in the air. And the giant came tumbling down. Boom, boom. We sing that a lot at my house. To tell the story of David and Goliath, right? What's the application? What's the point of David and Goliath? Go be a champion. Conquer the giants in your life. Now, I want to say, I don't think that's the main point. Here's what I mean. I'm just going to illustrate it fast. The story of David comes in a flow of the narrative of the book of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel 15, God rejects Saul as king. 1 Samuel 16, Samuel anoints a new king in Israel, a little shepherd boy named David. And then what happens in 1 Samuel 17? The great giant and enemy of God's people, Goliath, stands in mockery against God and against God's people and says, why don't you send a champion out? Who's going to fight me? And on the scene comes the newly anointed true king of Israel, the little shepherd boy David, who goes out and who fights in the place of God's people and who wins the victory for them that they could never win. The true king, God's anointed one, who fights on their behalf, in their place, so to speak. So in the story of David and Goliath, that little micro lens, how does that point us to Jesus? Friends, you're not meant to read yourself into the role of David in that story. We're meant to read ourselves as his brothers, sitting on the sideline, right? Watching a giant that we could never defeat of our own power, a giant that makes us tremble and quake in fear, right? What we need is not to be a David, we need a David. We need a great champion of God. We need God's anointed king, his Messiah, to come and fight the battles we could never fight, to defeat the enemies we could never defeat, so that we have our victory not because of our own strength, but because of him who fought in our place. You feel that, right? It's a small story, but it's not pointing for you to be God's champion. It's saying you need one. It's saying, why don't you quit trying to fight all the battles of your life yourself? Why don't you trust in the great champion of God who wins on behalf of God's people? I don't need to be a David, I need one. Friends, here's the way Tim Keller summarizes this. In the end, there are only two questions we can ask as we read the Bible. Is it all about me or is it all about Jesus? In other words, is the Bible basically about what I need to do or basically about what he has done? That's a crucial question to ask. And I want to just cast a vision to say, tomorrow, your job isn't simply to find an application for the day or a wisdom for living. Your job is to worship the hero of the story through the word. So, more next week on how we get there. Okay? Let me pray for us.